Okay, we spent a lot of time talking about how energy is important to our economies, how our industrial recent human economies are heavily dependent on fossil carbon and hydrocarbons. We might be asking now, well, how much of this stuff is left and how much is affordable? So let's take a step back. The picture on the left is an ancient swamp. After it died and was compressed under geologic time, it turned into peat, and after more time, it turned into coal of various qualities. The picture on the right is a bunch of diatoms, which are phytoplankton in the ocean. When they die, they go to the bottom of the ocean bed, get compressed, heated under geologic time between 10 and 500 million years, and turn into oil. No, oil is not dinosaur blood, it is ancient phytoplankton. We extract coal in various qualities that we dig up or mine near the surface, and we drill for oil. Oil starts in shale rock and then migrates to different traps and reservoirs, which we can drill and extract. So, last year, human economies used over 35 billion barrels of oil. That's a lot of oil. Question: how many years are left? 1.5? 15? 150? 1500? The answer is we don't know, but it's certainly not 1.5 and it's certainly not 1500. And it's somewhere in the next century or so that will be the end of our access to this energy dense carbon and hydrocarbons. There's a lot of confusion in the media about how this actually works. This graphic from the EIA shows the red is the cumulative production that we've already extracted and used. The dark blue is the proven reserves on oil company and national oil company balance sheets that we know we can find and affordably extract. The next shade of blue is reserves that we know are there that are economically recoverable. We haven't proved them up yet. The bright blue is reserves that we think are technically available to be recovered, but probably not economically. And then the rest of it is the remaining oil and gas in the source rock, in other areas that we know exist, but it would take more energy to get it out than it would be worth. Just as in nature, the benefits from various energy sources decline as the cost to obtain them increase. In the same way that a predator gets declining returns from declining small prey, humans have gone from accessing the easiest and cheapest and least environmentally damaged first to more complex, dirtier, and more costly fuels. For wells as recently as 20 or 30 years ago, all we would need is just steel pipe cemented into the hole and some solvent. But wells today cost many millions of dollars. A new shale well needs 100 train cars worth of sand, over 1,000 truckloads of water, and then perforations that cover thousands of feet of horizontal wellbore using complicated machinery and expertise. Overall, the cost of extracting oil for oil companies in the United States is 3 to 4 times more expensive than just 15 years ago. And just like it would for a cheetah, this much higher effort to find and obtain prey has implications for human economies. Oil discoveries peaked in the 1960s. We keep finding oil, but the vast majority of what we're finding is small to medium fields of lower quality, more expensive to extract variety. The Beverly Hillbilly days of just under the ground gushers are generations past. As wells and fields decline, we need to drill many more wells to replace the production of the early big fields. This graph shows the North Sea, which is between Norway and the United Kingdom. It peaked in the 1980s and again in 1999 and now is in terminal decline. Most countries have already peaked in their oil production. Only the USA and a handful of other countries like Russia, Iraq, Iran, Saudi Arabia have been increasing production during the past 15 years. So this is relatively easy to model. If we stopped all new investments in oil today, we can measure how much all the existing fields in the world would decline, even extracting the production that we expect from them in the future. And you can see in the above graph that by the year 2040, existing fields will decline by 80%. Okay? But there will be new investment, but that new investment is going to require higher oil price to be profitable to the oil companies. And recall that cheap oil makes everything else cheap, and expensive oil makes everything else more energetically remote, including roads, which are made from asphalt, which comes from oil, chemicals, medicine, trucking, etc. So with more costly and or less available oil, what sort of industrial processes and social arrangements will be impacted? Wait, are you referring to peak oil? Hasn't that been debunked? Well, there's a variety of estimates out there when oil, coal, and gas will peak and decline. One analysis shown above uses a low, base, and high scenario. The low scenario has things peaking around now, and the high scenario in about 50 years, mostly supported by vast amounts of natural gas. The low scenario would be very good news for climate, but bad for economies, and the high scenarios would be the opposite. The essential point is the distribution of natural resources follows a characteristic discovery and utilization curve, and these curves can be averaged to give a rough prediction of the future availability of that resource, and they often look like these three curves, like a normal curve per resource type and location. This is pretty straightforward, yet we disbelieve it. But when viewed from a 20,000-year lens, it becomes a bit more believable. We exist during the carbon pulse, where we extract various low-entropy materials from the Earth to keep our industrial society going, from metal ores to fossil carbon and hydrocarbons. Peak oil, the time when global production starts a permanent decline, was a poorly named concept. It probably should have been named peak benefits to society, to describe the phenomenon of having access higher and higher priced tranches of the remaining hydrocarbon pools, combined with the multiplier effect of a civilization using thousands of times of energy input for each human labor input. Peak benefits to society based on cheap oil is probably already a decade behind us. There are two completely different narratives in the media, and they even use the same charts. The graph on the left shows that the United States just pierced the 1970 peak of U.S. oil production. And this is evidenced in the media that the United States is energy independent. We're going to be an energy exporter. Technology can overcome any energy or resource problem. The graph on the right is the same graph, just broken down by province and area. And it shows that the conventional oil peaked in 1971 and has been declining ever since. Then we added the Alaska North Slope in the yellow, and then we added the Gulf of Mexico, not on the continental, but in the water. The red graph is tight oil, which is the source rock. The majority of U.S. oil production is now tight oil, which cost quite a bit more than the conventional oil. It's important to recall that all the debate about the shale miracle misses an important point. This is the source rock for hydrocarbons. After shale, there's really nothing left in the oil chain. And this is shale oil. It's actually rock. This is the shale revolution. We put chemicals and a lot of water and sand to blast open the pores of this rock so the microscopic particles of oil migrate into where we can pull them out. So over half of U.S. oil production is currently from the geological source rock like this. There's nothing after the source rock. Basically, the story of oil for the next 5 to 10 years could be endlessly debated. But for the next 20 to 50 years, which is when all of you will be productive adult citizens of the United States, it's much less debatable. Last week at the Davos conference, John Hess, the CEO of Hess Oil, said, "Shale is not the next Saudi Arabia. It is an important short-cycle component." As an aside, you can see that Minnesota is one of the few states that has absolutely no shale oil. Okay, the main points about energy depletion are this. Fossil energy underpins human economies. There's plenty of fossil carbon and hydrocarbons remaining, but extracting it is getting more energetic, more financial, and environmentally costly. Higher costs mean less benefits to human economies, which leads us to discussing switching and using alternative energies to coal, oil, and natural gas, which will be the subject in the next video called Energy Fungibility.